Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy. Welcome to the bottom of the barrel. And this afternoon, we're doing a twofer. Mostly because I'm going to be busy this coming weekend. I'm heading out of town. I'm going to L.A. I'm going to be going to a friend's wedding. And then I'm going to be at Nationals Bar and Grill on Sunday to watch Money in the Bank. If you happen to be in the L.A. area, and maybe you go to Nationals, maybe you don't, stop by. It's $10 cover charge to get in to see Money in the Bank. Come in. Check it out, hang out, watch the pay-per-view. Maybe you'll wind up on this show with me. I intend to bring the camera with me. Undertaker 0464, I'm sorry, Josh Molineros. I'm sorry, I know your name. I don't know your YouTube name. I'm bad about it. I apologize. And a couple other people from the YouTube wrestling community are going to be there. I thought Jeff Meacham was going to, but he's not. Anyway, I'm rambling. On to the point of this particular video. This video for my first video today is my review of Impact Wrestling, TNA, whatever they're calling themselves, Destination X. This pay-per-view, I probably would have paid for it if I could have, but, you know, it's not really, it was a position, I didn't even get to watch the pay-per-view at the time it happened. I've been actually watching it in chunks over the last 3 days while I've had little bits of downtime at work or times where the Spiffy Kitty isn't home because she really doesn't like TNA very much. But Destination X was a nice breath of fresh air for TNA at certain points because it did harken back to what made TNA good and made TNA different and made TNA be something more than just another WCW, which is what they currently are for the most part. They brought back the six-sided ring. I have no idea if it stayed. It was probably taken down immediately afterwards and they put up the four-sided ring right back up again. I guess that's okay, and it is what it is. I'm hoping that the six-sided ring stays. You know, I haven't read the Impact spoilers, so I don't know everything that happened, and I don't really give a crap. I'll watch Impact, Jesus, probably next Tuesday, because I'm going to be so freaking busy over the next couple of days. All right. So, I don't remember every match I saw, but I'll try to give you my rundown on it. First match, Samoa Joe versus Kazarian. This match was good. I'll be honest, I really felt that if they had come at it with the violence and the level of just SmackDown beat-em-up that they had given in the barroom brawls and stuff like that, I mean, Joe really, you know, Joe's like intense and really violent outside the ring. In the ring, he's just like, same set of maneuvers. I mean, Joe, you know, he's impactful. But, you know, it really comes down to it. He's, you know, the low drop kicks, the suicide dive. You've got the muscle buster and the Kukina clutch. You know, he's got, you know, I'm sure he's got more moveset to that. It's just that when it comes down to it, that's everything he does. And I wanted to see it get more violent. I wanted to see him brutalize Kazarian. And he really didn't. For the emotion and rivalry that's supposed to be in this match was very average. It wasn't bad, it just wasn't amazing either. I have to give this match a C+. It really just, it didn't do anything special for me as a ring, as a quality match. Next match, you have Douglas Williams versus British guy number 37,212. I don't remember what the guy's name was. To the point that even the Impact Zone was chanting, "Who are you? Who are you?" And, you know, I mean, when you got someone who was only ever shown on your European tour, don't expect your house group to go to be really excited about this guy. This match was, you know, this match was fast-paced and pretty good. Douglas Williams won the match, of course. And Douglas Williams showing a good sign of respect in the end and doing a handshake, which was kind of surprising considering he is usually a heel character and isn't that sort of way. And somebody tell me, I know that him and Magnus got back together, but when did Rob Terry rejoin the British Invasion? I knew that Rob Terry was kind of on the outs with Immortal, but I guess he's now back with the British Invasion, even though they humiliated him and beat the crap out of him and held him back and wouldn't let him have any matches and wouldn't let him do anything and called him the weak link of the group. Sure, we'll let you back in. No problem. No worries whatsoever. All is forgiven. I can just picture the conversation there. Douglas Williams like, listen, Mike, all is forgiven. You know, everything that you did that was bad, you know, we let forgive it. Rob Terry. But, you turned your back on me. Oh, that's in the past. Who worry about that? It's... And Rob Terry's like, okie doke, I'm gonna follow behind them. Yes, I went from British to Southern retard. Or goofy. And, alright, so then you have what they refer to as an impromptu tag team match with Eric Young teaming up with Stone Cold Shark Boy to take on the Generation Me, the Young Bucks, which turned out to be the Young Bucks' last match with TNA. They said, we're quitting. And frankly, I don't blame them. They had to job out to EY, who, while Eric Young's a great wrestler, he's a joke. His character's a joke. He's been a joke for a while, even though he is the television champion. And then there's Shark Boy, who wrestles on their internet matches. He doesn't even get TV time, and suddenly he's on the pay-per-view. I don't get it. I don't blame the Young Bucks for picking up and leaving. You know, I can't say that they would be better off going to the WWE. WWE hates tag teams, and seems these days so does TNA. So maybe the Bucks would be better off going back to Ring of Honor. They'll probably be a bit more appreciated there. This match, there was no story behind it. There was nothing behind it. So I couldn't. It was just a match. It had good spots, but. This is the problem I have, I think, with the X Division and sometimes with Ring of Honor, is that if there's no quality story behind a match, you could have a 5-star match as skills are concerned, but the audience won't give a crap if there's nothing behind it. If there's no build. If there's nothing there. So I really couldn't give a crap when I'm watching this match. I thought the Bucks would actually win it. They didn't. So there you go. So... EY, the TNA veteran and TNA television world champ with the two belts and what the fuck ever. This match was a C. It just, I couldn't give it any more than that. Let me think. Really, honestly, this pay-per-view didn't pick up until the main events of the card. You had the number one contenders, X match, which, I'm sorry, I'm blanking on the name of that type of matchup, but Ultimate X, duh. So the Ultimate X match, to be honest, this match was very predictable. It was obvious that they were going to put it on Alex Shelley. There was no tension, no drama in this match, but again, these athletes showed a lot of class and did a lot. Hell, even Robbie E did pretty well in there, and he's an annoying Zack Ryder wannabe. And this match, I have to give it a solid B, but I've seen it all before. I've seen the Ultimate X before, and I didn't see anything I hadn't seen before in this match. And I wish I could have seen more out of it. The Abyss, Brian Kendrick match. This match was both good and bad. It was good because we finally had the X title on an X Division guy again. Got the kitty rolling in on me here. But...
the new show host!
From the other issue that we have in that was that you had Immortal come out. And Scott Steiner and Bubba Ray and even Abyss, who was the X Division champion, all of them, they don't belong anywhere near the X Division guys. And... frankly, I was glad that that entire X Division roster came out and beat the holy tar out of them, and in the end, Brian Kendrick became champion. But that was the real flat side to it. I didn't need Eric Bischoff out there. I didn't need those guys out there. And it added to the storyline and boosted the match a little bit, but did they really think, oh, we've got money value now because we've given our big, fat, old guys FaceTime? I don't know. This match was a B-. Could have been better, could have been worse. I found it interesting how Abyss started off no-selling everything Kendrick did and eventually got weaker and weaker as he was separated from his Art of War book. I think that was a well-told story in the ring. I think it could have been done without Eric Bischoff coming out, although it was nice to see Eric Bischoff get punched in the face. Never a bad day when Eric Bischoff gets punched in the face. I know I probably missed something. Oh yes, RVD versus Jerry Lynn. How could I forget that? RVD versus Jerry Lynn, these two put on a match that was identical to every match they've had in ECW, except there wasn't as much chairs involved, at least not towards the end, until towards the end. These two always look great together, and it was always solid, and predictably, of course, RVD went over Jerry Lynn. I would have liked to have seen Jerry Lynn go over RVD. I mean, I know that Lynn's not under contract with TNA for any long term, and I know he's not sticking around, but come on, throw the guy a frickin' bone. That match, A-, those two always good, and the history behind them, need I say more on that? And then, of course, Daniels versus AJ Styles. Again, just like the match between RVD and Jerry Lynn, I think that Christopher Daniels should have gone over. I know that Daniels isn't as big of a star to TNA's mind as the phenomenal AJ Styles. He hasn't had as many belts. He's actually left the company. He's currently still under contract with Ring of Honor as well as working for TNA. You know, he plays a face on TNA and a heel on Ring of Honor. It's very confusing, I'm sure, for those people who watch both, and especially for somebody who happens to be a mark and believes it's all true. And then they're like, wait, but he's part of the Truth group over in Ring of Honor, but wait, he's part of Fortune over in TNA. He's good, but he's bad. And then their head explodes just like in Scanners, and it's awesome. These two put out everything they could, and they put on probably the most solid match of the night. And I was glad to see AJ pull out some maneuvers I hadn't seen him do because I never saw his earlier work. And it was nice to see Christopher Daniels just like the back and forth and the back and forth. And these two put on a solid match where they really showed these two knew each other. And that is something that's good, and you don't see that very often. This match was a solid A. I just wish that Daniels had gone over, but that's my personal opinion. Overall, this pay-per-view, solid B- for the entire pay-per-view. It wasn't as good as the last pay-per-view I reviewed for them, and I'll tell you why. It's because, generally speaking, there wasn't a ton of storyline leading up to this. It was just X Division matches. And while these matches are good, it falls under the category of too much of a good thing in some ways. It's like Lockdown. A cage match is good if you do it once in a while. When your entire card is cage matches, well, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and part one of my two-part shows today is complete. Matt Barrel has been scraped clean. It's an arm.
And a target.